Let's start looking at the most basic problem in proof of stake, the nothing at stake attack. This problem stems from the fact that all voting uses virtual resources rather than physical ones, like proof of work. Keep in mind the goal of the blockchain, to come to consensus on a single correct chain. Anything that prevents this from happening should be discouraged. If ever the blockchain ends up in a situation where consensus is not desirable for individual actors, then there is an issue. These two forks might continue on forever, and no one will come to consensus. What is it about proof of stake that makes this an issue? Take a look at the bottom image, demonstrating proof of work. As you know, proof of work implies that each actor has a limited amount of computational power that can be expended at any point in time. If a miner sees a fork, they will be forced to decide how to split up their voting power. If each fork has an expected chance of becoming the longest chain, then the best strategy is to maximize the overall expected value from your efforts. Fork A has a 90% chance of succeeding, so the expected value of mining on that fork is 0.9. Fork B, similarly, with a 10% chance of success, has a 0.1 expected return value. If the miner were to split their vote between forks, they'd end up with a 0.5 expected return. The best choice is to obviously mine exclusively on fork A for the highest expected value of return. But what happens in proof of stake under these same circumstances? Fork A again has 90% chance of success, and fork B a 10% chance. Voting exclusively on fork A has a 0.9 expected return, and exclusively on fork B a 0.1 expected return. But what about voting on both? Keep in mind that there's no physical restriction stopping someone from putting their signature on the next block of each fork. In fact, by voting on each block, the voter is able to maximize their expected return value. One of the forks must beat the other. This is a guarantee. If getting your votes into the longest fork is what gives you the most reward, why not vote in all forks so that you win no matter which fork is best? This leads to the expected value of voting on both forks as 1, making it the clear choice for any rational actor. This is troublesome because the implication is that there will never be a longest fork. Both forks will continue to grow indefinitely. Is there a way to solve this? Well, to discourage voting on incorrect forks, let's introduce a penalty to do exactly that. Though the solution is simple under the surface, it has great implications. There are two kinds of penalties to choose from. One is to punish anyone who votes on the wrong fork. The other is to punish anyone who votes on multiple forks. Both of these punishments are known as slashing. Because someone might vote on what seems like the right fork in their local view as honestly as possible, but is actually the wrong fork to the rest of the network, most proof-of-stake design choices choose the second version of the penalty. But how can we enforce this penalty? Keep in mind that each validator voting on a block provides a signature, demonstrating a conscious choice to put their stake behind a block. If we find conflicting signatures, meaning two blocks in different forks with signatures from the same validator, we can broadcast this information to the rest of the network as proof of their malicious activity. Because all voting is virtual, even the penalties for malicious voting strategies need to be explicitly enforced. As you can see in this example, we've now made it such that the best choice is to vote on fork A. This is because voting on fork B, or voting on both, now leads to penalties for the voter. One major attack that can be conducted in a proof-of-stake network is a long-range attack. In this scenario, attackers essentially create a new chain of transactions starting from the genesis block and then attempt to take over the main chain. There are two properties in proof-of-stake that allow this to happen: nothing at stake and weak subjectivity. Nothing at stake, which is explained earlier, allows for long-range attacks due to the costless nature of creating a branch. Next, there is weak subjectivity. When a new node joins a proof-of-stake network, the only block that is accepted is the genesis block. These nodes are also given all of the published chains, which makes it difficult for nodes to choose the main blockchain. Weak subjectivity is a problem both for new nodes and nodes that come online after being offline for long periods of time. Neither of these nodes know which of the chains they are given is the main chain. One preconception about blockchains in general is that the longest chain is the most trustworthy one. This can be said about proof of work, as the longest chain has the most computational work done on it. However, unlike in proof of work, in which the main chain can be determined quite easily by finding the longest chain, proof of stake has no easy way to determine this. This means that a chain that was created with the goal of executing a long-range attack can potentially be accepted as the main chain. To explain this clearly, we will step through an example. Suppose Gloria owns 1% of the tokens the moment the Genesis block is created. Instead of mining on the main chain, she mines on her own secret chain. Because it basically costs nothing to create blocks, Gloria can easily create a chain that is longer than the current main chain. If this chain is accepted and replaces the other chain, Gloria has effectively overwritten the entire blockchain history starting from a specific block. This is called a long-range attack because it can be executed from any point of the chain, including the Genesis block. Next, we'll take a look at the stake-grinding attack. This attack takes advantage of the fact that in a proof-of-stake protocol, we need a method of randomly picking the next validator. In case that validator is offline, we need a next validator we can call upon, and so on. In other words, we must create a protocol to develop an infinite random sequence of validators we can call upon in case the next one is offline. In practice, however, a validator will be found within the first few validators we call upon. In some proof-of-stake implementations, the validator chosen depends on the previous block's signature. The setup opens the opportunity for attackers to choose block signatures in the blocks they produce to increase their probability of getting chosen as a block validator. Attackers can choose from different block signatures by playing around with the block parameters to change the signature outcome. There are a few ways we can address this vulnerability. The first is that we can stop using any mutable parameters from the previous block to generate the random pick for the next validator. In other words, only parameters that miners have no control over should be used to generate randomness. We can also have all validators deposit their stake well in advance, so that individuals cannot plan on being a validator in the next round. Finally, we can have some secret sharing mechanism where we have multiple validators come to consensus on some random value that can help pick the validator for the next round. Unless there is collusion within the majority, this strategy should work.